see, lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire, filled with catastrophe, but she knows she can fly away.
Series, Bold Women Change History. My name is Dawn DePrince. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for History Colorado, and this is the primary public forum for the Women's Vote Centennial Colorado, which began on the Capitol steps on Women's Equality Day last August and will culminate this summer on the 100th anniversary of the 19th Amendment. Before we start tonight, we would like to acknowledge, in the spirit of healing and education, the 48 contemporary tribes with historic ties to the state of Colorado. These tribes are our partners. We consult with them when we plan exhibits, collect, preserve, and interpret artifacts, do archaeological work, and create educational programs, we recognize these Indigenous peoples as the original inhabitants of this land. We are really delighted that you are all here with us this evening. We miss spending time with you in real life, but we are honored that you have invited us into your homes for this very special presentation. Our Bold Women Change History lecture series is part of our inclusive statewide effort to commemorate the passage of the 19th Amendment. As many of you know, Colorado was ahead of the nation more than 25 years as the first state to remove gender discrimination from the ballot by popular referendum. More recently, America watched Colorado make history again just last week. In the middle of a crippling pandemic, Colorado voters produced the largest turnout ever in a non-presidential primary in our state, roughly 45%. The New York Times called it, quote, almost too good to be true, end quote. And tonight's presenter can help us understand exactly how it happened and what it means for America. We are so delightfully engaged in commemorating this incredible history and connect it to current events through a collaborative effort led by History Colorado, the Governor's Women Vote Centennial Commission, and all of you. We are pleased, as always, that some of our commissioners are joining us tonight and applaud their support for this important work. We also recognize the Chambers Fund, Kathy McLean Finlan and Richard Finlan, Peter and Rhonda Grant, former Lieutenant Governor Donna Lynn, and the Honorable Wilma J. Webb and the Honorable Wellington Webb for the outstanding financial support of this effort. Please consider joining these leaders in support of this important work by becoming a member of History Colorado. If you aren't already a member, head over to historycolorado.org/membership to join anytime. We are deeply grateful for this kind of support, especially in these challenging times. Thank you. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, please note that we will be answering questions at the end of the presentation. You can just easily type your questions into the chat box at the bottom of the screen. Now, I would like to welcome tonight's presenter. Amber McReynolds is one of the country's leading experts on election administration and policy. We just are lucky that she happens to live here in Denver and in Colorado. She is co-author of the book, When Women Vote, is proudly on sale at the gift shop at History Colorado Center. She is also the CEO for the National Vote at Home Institute and Coalition and the former director of elections for Denver. During her time there, she transformed the elections division into a national and international award-winning office. She has proven that designing pro-voter policies, voter-centric processes, and implementing technical innovations will improve representation for all voters. Amber serves also on the National Election Task Force on Elections Crises, and as an advisory board member for MIT's Election and Data Science Lab. She is a board member for Lift Colorado and Represent Women, and serves on various advisory boards for other national organizations focusing on improving election administration. Amber holds a Master of Science degree in Comparative Politics from the London School of Economics and a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science and Communications from the University of Illinois. So I will turn it over to our bold woman for the evening, Amber McReynolds.
Oh, thank you so much, Dawn. And it's so great to be here. And thanks so much to the Bold Women series, the board, History Colorado for hosting this incredible series. You know, when the pandemic started, the first kind of thought I had was, goodness, we're gonna lose access to all of the Bold Women series events, but I'm so happy that History Colorado has adjusted programming so that we can all continue to engage in this way, and especially in this historic year. So I'm just really honored to be invited to be a part of this and share not only what we were able to do in Colorado to really improve the voting process for all, but also share a lot about what's happening around the country. Because I promise there's a lot of work left to do in a very short period of time to help states get ready for the upcoming election. I'm going to share my screen here because I do have a little presentation that I want to share. And we'll get this up here. So as Dawn said, I'm the CEO of the National Vote at Home Institute, and we're a nonpartisan nonprofit established to expand exactly what we were able to do in Colorado. And the organization's been in existence for a few years now, and we've been working across the country in almost every state, working on policy objectives around voting at home, expanding options for voters to ensure all voters can vote. And our work really falls into three big areas. We focus on policy design and advocacy, so very similar to the work that I and a small group of us, mainly women, actually did in Colorado 7 years ago, where we designed a new law and a new reform for how voting would happen going forward. And that's really put Colorado on the map in terms of being one of the best places to vote, one of the safest states to vote in, and one of the most accessible with the highest turnout, highest registration rate around the country, all achievements that would not have happened without the collaboration that some of us were engaged in 7 years ago now. So our model is 7 years old, and I certainly every day wish that more states would have moved in this direction prior to this 2020 cycle that we're in. The second area of work is implementation support. So our organization is focused on supporting election officials around the country, state and local, helping them scale systems, helping them implement the policy changes that happen. What I found when I came to the nonprofit space is that a lot of times national organizations will come in or they'll advocate for policies, but then they leave the implementation up to the localities or to the states. And there's a lot of support that needs to happen to make sure the laws are implemented well and that there's good resources around them. And then the final area of work is really about communications and education of not only the policy itself, but supporting partner organizations that educate the public. We focus on educating the public in a broader way, also policymakers. So there's a whole communication aspect to the work that we do. And our work and in our nonprofit really falls into those three areas. I've been on board at the National Vote at Home Institute since the fall of 2018. Prior to that, as Dawn mentioned, I was the Director of Elections for the City and County of Denver and really helped to oversee the transformation, if you will, of the Denver Elections Office that's occurred over the last decade or so. And we really changed our mission and our way of thinking to focus on putting voters first. And I'm going to talk a lot about that tonight because I truly believe that the only way to strengthen our democracy is to actually put voters first, because our democracy is essential. It's critical for who we are as a people, and our democracy in and of itself has left people out over time. And we knew that back in 1920 with the fight for women's suffrage and the decades that occurred under right before that. We saw it with the Voting Rights Act in terms of enfranchising more voters to vote. And even today, which I'll talk about today, voters are still being left out. And now the pandemic has exposed the real vulnerabilities that exist in the traditional way of voting that exists in most states. So Colorado has really led in this area, and we are trying to advance that, replicate all the great things that have happened here. And encourage other states to look west, as I always say, since a lot of the Western states now have this model as well. A couple of unique things about our organization as well. We support state and local officials, as I mentioned, with implementation. We provide guidance to policymakers. And then we've also, this year especially, been advising governors and top elected leaders within states on how they can adjust in emergency situations the voting process. And there's a ton of work that goes into that. What I will tell you is that presidential elections take at least a year to plan, and the pandemic threw an entire new set of issues into the middle of the process this year, which has put election officials in a really difficult place around the country. So organizations like ours, as well as some of our partners and groups that we work with, are trying really hard to support the election official community, which is just underwater right now with trying to find enough people to work in the election process, find good locations, adjust their procedures and processes, some of which have been followed or done a certain way for decades. And so it's I kind of like to call it, it's as difficult as turning the Titanic as quickly as possible, right? So there's a ton of work to do. And we're here along with many of our partners on the ground every day trying to make that happen. As Dawn mentioned, I also wrote a book with my dear friend, Stephanie Donner, who's also an incredible leader, woman leader in Colorado. She's the president of Emily Griffith Technical College. And we wrote a book that was released January 30th of this year. And what's interesting about it is we talk about, we have a tie back to the suffrage movement and all of the women and incredible women leaders that came before us. But we interviewed various women after the 2018 cycle, the 2018 election cycle, and tried to highlight the barriers that many women still face. And not only just women, but really all voters. And so our book talks about solutions to that. And I'm going to show a quick little video here that just describes what the book's about and then some of the other points that I'll talk about tonight.
100 years ago, a movement that began in the Western United States culminated in women achieving the right to vote. But today, so many women still lack the opportunity to vote. Barriers such as restrictive voter registration processes and deadlines and inconvenient or non-existent voting options make the voting process difficult for many voters. These barriers prevent people from participating in our democracy. The 2016 presidential election and the 2018 midterm election saw record numbers of voters and turnout, but still only accounted for 61% and 49% of eligible voters in America. There's a lot more we can do to improve voter engagement. Solutions include providing more convenient options for voters, such as voting at home, early voting, automated and same-day registration, and primary reform. By empowering voters with more options, we can increase engagement and voter turnout. In fact, the states that have already implemented these policies are the states with the highest voter turnout in the nation. And when voter turnout increases, more women vote. And when more women vote, we get better representation in our government. And with better representation, we get better policies on issues like healthcare, education, and pay equity. But all of this will fail to happen unless we modernize our elections and the way we vote. Our election policies must put voters first and focus on who votes, not who wins. Let's build on what women fought for so bravely 100 years ago, because great things happen for everyone when all women vote.
Okay, so that's the little video, and we actually released
100
that.
100 years ago, a movement.
We released that last fall, and what's incredible is that we obviously talk about voting at home as a solution, and with the pandemic that came about this year, that has become even more critical in the 2020 election cycle, because we need to have safe and secure voting options for voters. So not only did we build a system in Colorado that puts voters first, streamlines the process, saves and conserves costs around elections, reduces the number of poll workers and people required to run an election, which helps with costs, but we also actually built a more resilient election system. And I like to describe this because we our goal was to meet voters where they were in their everyday lives and streamline the process, just like we have so many other areas of our lives. And that has proven to be highly effective when voting in a pandemic. And so it has absolutely become a model for the rest of the country. Oregon and Washington came before Colorado. And what we tried to do in Colorado was learn from those states that came before us, improve upon it, add to it, and make it work for Colorado. And so I always like to say there's not a perfect cookie cutter model for every single state, because there are going to be different dynamics that happen on the ground in each state. but it's a great model to start with. And it's always good to continuously improve. And I always encourage states to continue to adjust using the baseline principles that we laid out here in our state, but then also improve and make it better for their states as well. So the system in and of itself managed to still have second highest turnout in the presidential primary in March, now the top turnout for a state primary in Colorado's history, all in the midst of a time when we are not gathering in large groups, and thus the model proved that it does work, in fact, for voters. So we're seeing significant adjustments across the state, right, across the country right now, with regards to policies that we've been working on for a few years, but that have become tremendously important this year. And the other thing that we're seeing is that voters are the ones choosing this method of voting around the country. I'll show a graph in a few minutes of sort of the trends that we've seen in terms of voting at home and what it looks like and what it means for 2020. First on screen, you see a map, and we highlight this in our book, but this shows the status of suffrage as of 1920, when the 19th Amendment was finally ratified. And what's interesting, if you look at this, the darker states, women were enfranchised before the 19th Amendment. So as of kind of August, right before ratification happened, this is what the country looked like. And then in kind of the center of the country and some of the Northeast states, they were enfranchised to a certain extent. And then in the states that are all white, they had no suffrage at all. What's interesting about that, this is, you can kind of see there the color schemes, but this is the vote at home status by state as of May of this year. And if you see the darker blue states, all, by the way, in the West mostly, those are the states that have expanded voting options for voters in the most expansive way. And so before COVID even hit, these states were moving in the direction of offering more options. California became the most recent state to announce that they're going to mail a ballot to every single elector in November, something that we worked on, and California actually modeled their legislation off of Colorado. We've also had other states jump into that announcement. Montana has expanded options significantly. Many states have put the absentee ballot application online, or added ballot tracking, like something that we initiated actually back in Denver in 2009. We've also seen states mail out applications to every one of their electors. Vermont and Delaware and Massachusetts all have passed legislation in the last couple weeks. We've been working on legislation in states like Michigan and Georgia to make further changes to their system. Illinois passed legislation to expand. So we've literally seen expansions within the last 4 months because of COVID in a very significant way. For the first time, New Yorkers could vote by absentee ballot without an excuse. New Jersey sent a ballot to every single elector for their primary that was held on Tuesday, with the exception of unaffiliated voters. So we've just seen these huge expansions. But you can see before COVID, it was Western states, just like it was with suffrage. And so as I've looked at this in terms of change and reform, it can take a really long time. And there's something about Western states where there were more frontier, more frontierism in terms of our approach, more accessible, not sure, but there is a trend here that was stood out to us as being very obvious as we designed the book. And this, as I mentioned, this is the going into 2018, and I want to show this because of the significant change that we've seen in 2020. But going into 2018, going back to 1992, you can see on this graph the trend in terms of the methods of voting that voters have chosen. The blue line on top is in-person voting. So going back to 1992, it was over 90% of votes cast were cast in person on Election Day. Then we started seeing more states adopt early voting and expand mail-in voting right around that time. So the orange line is early voting in person, and that tends to, it sort of stayed fairly stagnant, and it goes up and down depending on the presidential cycle. But mail-in voting, being the green line, has been on a steady incline. And going into 2020, our projections were that we would see about 50% of the country vote by mail. And the reason for that is there's been a tremendous number of people and surge just opting themselves in over the last few years. And we've seen significant growth in various states, including Arizona and Montana, which are now well over 75% of their voters choosing to vote by mail. Then COVID hit. And so we've actually been thinking about these numbers in a completely different way. And I actually think that close to 70%, maybe even higher than that, of voters in the country may end up using a vote by mail ballot come November. And so what that means is it's a significant shift in terms of the processes, procedures, what states are used to, and even the volume associated with preparing all of those mail ballots to go out. So not only have we been engaged with working with state and local election officials, but we've also been working with the vendor community to actually make sure the supply chain is solid, that there's capacity to print mail ballots in this way, and that there's an ability to get them out in a timely fashion. So it's been a fascinating road, if you will, to be been in the middle of helping with all of these different things that are emerging to be critical issues for 2020. I also want to just talk a second about what goes into the concept of vote by mail and vote at home systems. A lot of people sort of think, oh, it's mailing a ballot out, and as long as the ballots get to voters, that's all that goes into the policy. But there's actually over 30 different policy issues that we focus on when we're advocating or trying to expand this model. And that includes things like how ballot delivery works. And so not only do we wanna mail a ballot to everybody, but we also wanna make sure voters have an accessible vote at home option. And we wanna make sure military voters have options when they're serving overseas where international mail may be challenging. We also wanna make sure that we proactively update addresses. So through the national change of address, like what we set up in Colorado 7 years ago now, or through the state conglomerates like ERIC, where there's data sharing across states, so that you don't, as a voter, don't have to keep filling out multiple forms. We use government systems to automatically update those addresses to make sure we get your ballot to the right place. Also effective cure processes. So when we do signature verification, if your signature doesn't match, we have a way to get that cured and contact you and let you cure that. Signature verification is a critical security feature, but we also need to make sure that voters aren't left out of that process and that they can cure any discrepancies get flagged. In-person voting. So it's always funny to me when people say universal vote by mail or all vote by mail, because there actually isn't a system like that. Every one of the states that automatically mail a ballot to every voter also has really good in-person voting options available in the event that a voter loses their ballot or doesn't receive it or needs to register to vote on election day or just wants to vote in person. So the concept of vote centers was born also in Colorado, led by Scott Doyle, who used to be the clerk in Larimer County, and Jan Coonan, who was the deputy clerk in Larimer County. They kind of created the concept of vote centers that literally has become something that's also spreading around the country. And what we did in our model is we took vote by mail and combined it with vote centers to create the best possible voting experience for all electors. We also instituted ballot drop-off options. So the 24-hour boxes that you see across the state, the drive-up drop-offs that you see and that you drop your ballot off with. And you can drop your ballot at any county in the state. You're not constricted to just the county that you live in. Risk-limiting audits, another huge implementation that we led on as a state, being the first state to implement it statewide. Prepaid postage is another policy consideration. That's not something that Colorado does. However, Colorado does have an agreement with the post office, and there's this also agreement nationally that if a voter doesn't put adequate postage on, it will be covered by the election office, just to ensure that nobody gets left out of the process. And then adjusting counting timelines and ballot processing windows and all of that. So this is an example, but you can see that there's a lot of policy issues that go into making Colorado's system great for not only voters, but also as an example around the country. And one analogy I wanna give here. So this has become a significant issue with COVID, where more and more people are having their groceries delivered, packages delivered. We've all ordered something online. I've got the example of Amazon up here, which I know is always controversial. Some people love Amazon and some people don't. It's kind of a love-hate thing. But this concept of mail voting is very similar. You think about when you go online to order something, that's kind of like the registration process where you're putting in your details, making sure your address is correct, all of those things. And then you're ordering a product and then it's being delivered to you. That's kind of how this is. This is sort of a concept like that that Americans are very used to using, whether it's ordering a Lyft, ordering something online, making a reservation online, whatever those things might be. This is kind of how that works. And what I've been saying to folks too is that if we did voting the way that a lot of states do, you'd be registering to vote online. So ordering your product online, which is your ballot, but you'd be required to go pick it up at the Amazon facility and wait in a 5-hour line to get it. That doesn't work so well. So our system really puts voters first, meets voters where they are. And that's exactly what this analogy and concept kind of demonstrates and what we're trying to get to happen in other states. This was also mentioned in the video, but we talk a lot about this in the book. In the back of the book, we actually have a playbook that describes how to improve our elections and how to strengthen our democracy. And that includes improving the voting transaction, improving voter registration, improving mail ballot and vote at home options, early voting, expanding options for voters, but also focusing on things like fair redistricting and campaign finance reform and open primaries, making sure that there's not barriers in the process for voters to be able to participate. And what I like to call, it's this formula that you see on screen. It's about putting voters first with pro-voter policies. It's about designing voter-centric processes that put voters at the center of that transaction. It's about implementing effective technology. The great thing we were able to do in Colorado is adjust our policies, pass good laws, implement good processes, and then build technology that supports all of that. A lot of states have made the mistake of trying to buy technology and machines, thinking that it can fix a bad process, when actually most of the issues we see in elections are because of a flawed policy or process. And so all of these things combine to improve the voting experience. And I believe in my heart of hearts that improving the voting transaction, making it easier for you as a voter to engage so that we can increase engagement and turnout to historic levels, is the best path forward and the best movement, modern day movement, that we can achieve as a country in terms of making our democracy even stronger. In 2016, as you saw in the video, 80 million people who were eligible and registered to vote did not participate. And when asked why, a good percentage of them, more than 40%, cited a barrier, couldn't get off work, couldn't make it to the voting hours during the restricted time their state had, didn't have the option to vote by mail. They cited all these barriers. They didn't cite a lack of will. They cited barriers. And so if we can streamline this process in the way that we've done in Colorado, replicate it across the country, we can achieve historic turnout. We can get those numbers up to not only what Colorado has, but beyond that in a lot of ways. And if we don't act, and this is really, you're going to see a lot of photos that come up on screen now. And if we fail to act and we don't get this right, not only in a pandemic, but also for long term, we're going to continue to see the headlines, the long lines, the issues that voters face every single time. And all of these images you're seeing on screen right now, except for the final one, were actually from 2018. And if we go back to 2016, the same kind of headlines about long lines and barriers and machine malfunctions and overcrowding, all of these things have happened every single cycle for the last 20 plus years, going back to Florida 2000. So we know these issues are going to come up every time. And yet politicians and policymakers with an ability to address it have failed to do so in a lot of states. And the final image that you see online is actually a photo from Wisconsin's primary election in April. And that election, I was particularly paying a lot of attention to, because they had so many legal battles in the month leading up to the election. And that kind of thing can be so destructive to election officials trying to administer the election, voters in terms of creating confusion. And all of those legal battles continue to ensue. And ultimately, the people that were hurt most by it were the voters standing in line on election day because they didn't have a safe and secure option. And election officials were put in a terrible position, not funded, didn't have enough poll workers, didn't have enough locations, a tsunami of issues that all played out in the middle of the pandemic. And so if we fail to act and we don't get this right, we're going to see those same issues again in November. And what I'll also say is there's not a perfect election, right? So there's always going to be things that we can continue to improve on. But what we don't want to see is these systemic issues that we continue to see over time. And our work at Vote at Home, and also what Stephanie and I wrote about in the book, is centered around that. It's about improving the voting process and the voting experience for every single elector, regardless of their circumstances on a daily basis. And I believe that's what we set out to do in Colorado, and certainly our vision in Denver when we reformed a lot of these things was to put voters first. And I think that that's what our new movement has to be about in this country, about putting voters first, setting aside the partisan fighting over election rules and regulations and all of that, and simply committing to putting voters first so that we can have an inclusive system for everyone to vote in and everybody to be proud of. So with that, I'm really grateful to be here. Thank you again to History Colorado and Dawn for having me. I wanted to leave a ton of time for questions. I already see there's questions in the chat. Those are always the most interesting to me. The one thing that I've got my contact information in the websites up online, but also I'll just highlight this photo is one of the most important photos to me, but I was named a Governing Magazine Public Official of the Year with a few other leaders around the country back in 2018. And I was able to take my kids with me, and my daughter asked if she could go up on stage when I gave my speech and got the award. And so she did. And it was just a wonderful moment for her, and hopefully one that influences how she engages with everything she does going forward. So thank you so much, Dawn, and thanks to History Colorado. And I look forward to the questions.
Thank you, Amber. We already, as you know, have a bunch of questions, but since I am the one asking the questions, I'm gonna ask my question first.
Sure.
One of the things that struck me throughout your talk is that the way you were talking about voting is almost from a business perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Putting voters first is almost this idea of voters as customers, that the transaction is built in a way that makes it possible for them to participate in this process. And so I just wonder, is that been some of your thinking, like thinking about this more as a business process and a business prospect? How has that kind of entrepreneurial way of thinking influenced your thoughts on developing these new processes?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, it's very similar to the customer first kind of mentality that a lot of businesses approach their customers with. And, you know, we, as I've worked in this industry for a very long time, and not only worked on the policy side in Colorado, but then nationally and across many states, change ends up being the biggest barrier that we face. And almost every not every state exactly, but a lot of our conversations, when I go talk about changing the election system within a state with policymakers, one of the first questions they ask is, would I win if this change happens? And sometimes they ask that directly, and sometimes they ask that implicitly. And I won't comment on where the questions come from in terms of the gender breakdown on that. However, it feels a lot like the 19th Amendment. I watched the story the other night on PBS where that was exactly the topic. It was about outcomes and who was going to win and did we really want to enfranchise women because what if this changed and all of that. And I feel like that's a lot of the same barriers that we face today. It's this hyper focus by policymakers because they have a personal stake in the outcome of the election, and that influences their decision making. And what's interesting about that is we're one of the only democracies that has so much partisanship within our election process. So a lot of countries, it's more of a technical, professional process where it's even independent in most cases from the political infrastructure. Here, we have elected partisan secretaries of state, we have elected clerks or election officials at the local level, and all of the work they do, even though they're mostly nonpartisan and approach their jobs in that way, they're beholden and reliant on a partisan legislature that a lot of times doesn't want to change the thing that got them elected. So voters first is exactly that. It's setting aside the partisan politics and just simply focusing on how do we build a better system that serves all, puts voters first, and doesn't focus so much on the who wins part of it, but more on the who votes part.
Great, thank you. We have a number of, I would say, sort of nuts and bolts questions that I think are really important. I mean, as your earlier comment, some of this really is technical detail. And I think it's also getting those technical things right is what's going to create trust in voters. So I wanted to ask just a few of these. You know, when you say vote at home, is that mail-in ballot or is that by computer? How do you define vote at home?
Yeah, so I mean, the reason that we've deemed it vote at home, and honestly, this has also created a little mini movement. A lot of people used to call it absentee voting and vote by mail, and we've tried to move people to talk about voting at home, mainly because that's where you are actually voting. You're making your decisions in the privacy of your space, whether that be at your home or friends or your work or what have you, but it's your space. And we also have found, especially in Colorado, that most people drop their ballot off in person. So the voted ballot, even though people like to receive it via mail, the vast majority of people like to drop off their ballot at a drop box or a drive up or any of those things. And then we also wanted to be very expansive with the terminology, because when you say vote by mail, that is only paper. And the reality is there's some voters that need accessible technology. We believe that they should have that in a secure way at home. So there's now modifications to various systems that have happened and been piloted around the country, including a really great platform that California now has where they call it remote accessible vote by mail. And you get your ballot to your home computer. And so if you require a SIP and PUF device or other assistive technology, you can actually vote your ballot on your screen, but then print the piece of paper that then gets submitted back into the election office. So votes aren't transferred online in that way. It's more of a ballot marking situation where then the paper ballot is submitted. So that's why the term is that way. And we're trying to be very inclusive with the terminology as opposed to limiting, which is some of the other more historic ways to talk about this.
So I've had this question as well, and it's come up in our chat. When do clerks count the ballots that come in the mail? Do they do that counting early, or does it all have to wait until the polls close on election night?
Yeah, so most states actually allow the processing of ballots in advance, and Colorado is one of those states. Most of the Western states, most states actually, you can process ballots as they come in. So that means receiving them, date stamping them, checking the signatures, processing and prepping them for counting, flattening them, and you know, securing them for the counting process to occur. And then in counting, there's a couple of different processes that happen. There's scanning, so that's scanning of the paper ballot so that it captures what the voter's intent is off of the ballots. And then the final step is what's called tally. Tally does not happen till election night. So when you see those results at 7 o'clock, literally the tally is right at that point, and then it's uploaded into a public-facing website. The scanning can happen prior to election day, but the tally cannot. So that's a big distinction, and that protects the results from being released too early, which is a key part of our of conducting an election and making sure that there's security around those results. The problem, however, is in some states where they still have antiquated laws, like in Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, they don't allow their clerks to process the ballots at all until election day. So our organization, we've been trying to get that policy adjusted in those states because it's going to significantly burden those election officials on election day. And it's also going to potentially delay results. And those states are kind of in a minority of states, if you will, that have those overly restrictive processes.
Fascinating. You know, and I think anytime we talk about mail-in ballots and mail-in elections, there's concern about what if the ballots go to somebody who has died? Is there any, you know, undue influence in a home where people feel like they're having to vote the way of, you know, their husband or some other dominant person in the home? What do you have to say to those kinds of concerns?
Yeah, well, that I do get asked this. And, you know, I think that what's really important for me when I think about these issues is our democracy is essential. We need to make sure that it's strong, not only to protect voters, but also to protect it from anyone who tries to do something that they shouldn't be doing, not only to voters, but also to the system as a whole. And so the protections to protect voters, protect their rights, protect their access, all of those things are really important. And then cybersecurity, for as an example, is also has a whole another aspect of it that is critically important in securing the election process. And then also from bad actors, whether it be people trying to influence voters in a negative way. We've seen this actually happen with in-person voting, where people will do robocalls and tell voters to go to the wrong polling place or put a flyer on someone's door that gives them the wrong information about a polling place. We've seen that happen historically. We've also seen voters be misdirected about procedures or told the wrong day for the voting process to happen. Those things have all happened historically in in-person voting. And then with mail-in voting, same thing. Need to make sure that voters have a private and secure way to vote, that they can report instances if they feel like they're being intimidated, just like if you intimidate someone outside the polling place when they're trying to go in and vote, just like if you try to buy someone's vote, all of those things are illegal. And we have to make sure that those practices are, you know, that we fight against those in the laws, but then that we also have a reporting mechanism should something bad happen. And we spent a lot of time actually when we were forming the policies around that Colorado would ultimately adopt. We spent a lot of time talking to the homeless community and providers that support homeless voters because they have mailing addresses, but they don't have residential that's consistent. And so we wanted to make sure that we weren't adversely impacting voters in that with those logistical issues. And then we also spent a lot of time talking to domestic violence providers and various victim rights groups about the impact there and what the concerns might be. And what we ended up doing, and this goes way into the policy arena, but in Colorado, as an example, if you get a mail ballot mailed to you at home, and if you feel intimidated, number one, you should report that immediately to your election official so that that can be investigated. But number two, there's a recourse. So even if you were victimized in your home, and someone, you then, you know, mail the ballot off or it was mailed off for you, you can actually call the office and say, this happened. I need to either get a ballot mailed to a different address or I need to come in person. You have that ability to do that in Colorado if that happens to you. You also can show up in person the day after. Maybe the ballot's not there yet because it was mailed. And you can explain this. And the election officials can take care of you because we have those protections built in the law. But again, these are the sorts of things, whether it be in-person voting or mail voting, and I actually think there's more issues with in-person voting. That was my historical experience in terms of voters having bad things happen to them than mail-in voting. And what we need to know, though, election officials need to know if something bad happens. They need to get that report. They need to know about misinformation. If someone is trying to spew the wrong information or tell voters the wrong thing or reduce their confidence or lie about the process, whatever it is, we need all those things to be reported so that we can adequately protect voters.
Thank you. So we have a question in our chat around the centuries, decades have been fraught with excluding voters from different communities, whether, you know, it was women prior to 1920. But then we have a very long legacy post 1920, right, of Jim Crow laws and other practices and policies in place of violence and intimidation that have made people distrustful of the system. And specifically, the question in the chat was around distrust of the system around voting within the Black community. And so what do you think that mail-in voting or voting from home helps to build back some of that trust? Or what do you have to say to somebody that says, we don't trust the system because we have a long legacy of being hurt by the system?
Yeah, no, and it's a critical question, and it's an important sort of body of work that's happening, because confidence in the process is so critical to an improved voting experience. And what I mean by that, there's all kinds of ways that confidence gets destroyed, frankly, for voters, whether it be they have a registration issue, they thought they were registered to vote, and somehow they find out that they weren't. Somebody trying to intimidate them on the way in, them being knocked off the rolls when they shouldn't have been, all of those things like play into that destruction, if you will, of confidence. Then there's the misinformation. So if they're told a certain thing or they hear something that's inaccurate, all of that can add to that. And then the one that I think is the most destructive, and I showed this on screen with some of the photos, if you wait in line for 6 or 7 hours to cast a ballot in 2020 or 2018 or 2016 or any of these years that we've seen this, you wait in line that long, the confidence you have in your vote mattering, counting, all of those things is destroyed with every few minutes that you stand there. And so I think that these long lines, and frankly, it's interesting because I think that, you know, voter suppression needs to be called out for what it is. It needs to be investigated. It needs to be, people need to be held accountable if they engage in that. But a lot of what we see that gets described as that is actually administrative deficiencies or lack of funding or lack of locations. And it's administrative problems where elections just aren't run well. Like there might not be deliberate attempts, but it's actually administrative malfunction, I call it. That actually creates probably more of the issues that we see around the country. And those are those really long lines and machine malfunctions or people not understanding what they should do. All of that, I think, destroys voter confidence, and it's gonna make it really hard to convince voters to go back and deal with that again after they do it once before.
That makes me think about all of the layers of control that happen with our voting process, right? Like the federal government has some control, state governments have significant control over who's able to vote. And then, you know, you get down to the local level and whoever that administrator may be. Do you think that that complicates our system? You know, part of me thinks without state control over elections, we wouldn't have seen women being able to vote pre-1920. But because states had so much control over elections, we also see the devastating impact of Jim Crow laws. So, and then you've got the very practical impacts of, you know, maybe an administrator that, you know, doesn't have enough funding or isn't doing things correctly. So, How do all those layers of control help or hurt our system?
Yeah, and it's a balance. So I sort of talk about this because you're right. Like women would not have gotten the right to vote had states not had control prior to 1920. It just wouldn't have happened. And it possibly never would have happened, because even if you look at that map of vote at home, a lot of innovations that we see tend to be incubated within a state. And then they start expanding once they work, right? And we've got a lot of examples of that actually. So I think there's a balance to strike, but what I believe is problematic in our system is that we have had examples of the federal government weighing in on election policy. Help America Vote Act was passed after Florida 2000, that UACAVA, the Voting Rights Act, YAMUVA. We've had a lot of examples of the federal government, you know, providing either financial support or guidance to states on trying to create some consistencies. The National Voter Registration Act is another one back in the 90s. So there's been examples. I think that Congress has almost been too hesitant with some of what they've done. The most recent example we have of that is the CARES Act. So there was election funding put into that. It was only $400 million. We expect, you know, there to be about 260 million voters registered to vote this year. Boeing and the airline industry got $60 billion in that same package to make sure that they could stay afloat. And elections for 260 million people, 50 states, and over 7,000 different local jurisdictions got $400 million, even though the number that's needed, that many of us estimated, was between $2 and $3 billion. So Congress, I think, failed to provide the necessary funding support that elections would need in COVID. And that's been highly problematic as we've been trying to implement a lot of these expansions right now and make sure that voters have a safe experience. So Congress plays a role. And I think the other thing I would say about this is the fact that you're more eligible to vote or you have more access in a presidential year if you live in Colorado versus what you have if you're a resident of Missouri or Alabama is highly problematic, I believe, in a presidential year because, you know, we're running a presidential election and yet some people are more eligible to vote than others. And if you're in Colorado, you can register to vote and vote on the same day. In Missouri, you know, you've got a 30-day requirement and you can't do that. You'll be handed a provisional ballot and it may or may not count. So I think we've got work to do to not say that this is the cookie cutter and this is how it has to be, but provide some guardrails and some guidelines for standards that all states can adopt and adhere to.
Wonderful. Well, I think that concludes all of our discussion for tonight. I think what's really incredible is I am hearing you talk. It's really in our homes. Like it goes from, you know, the space in our homes, like we are tonight, but all to the utmost, you know, heights of power within this country. This is something that is at all of these layers and levels, and as it should be, it's really, really important. You've given us a lot of insight, and I think hope as we think about how we can just provide greater access to voters throughout our democracy. And I know Luda, one of our teammates throughout the evening, has been sharing some really great links and ways that you can follow Amber on Twitter or check out her book. So thanks so much, everybody, for joining us for this incredible conversation. And we will just keep this going. This is the maybe not the kickoff, but we are in the midst of a very historic election year. And democracy is at its utmost importance. So thanks for being engaged in these really important conversations tonight.
Thank you.
You can be amazing, turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast, be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle beneath your skin. Kept on the inside and no sunlight, sometimes a shadow wins.